Okay, so let's start the third lecture. So today we'll talk about more details on the Zyber-Kwitten system. That's integrable system that's associated to n equals 2, d equals 4 gauge theory on the Coulomb branch of vacua that we talked about in the last lecture. Now, let me actually draw a general picture for that I will try to expand on it in the last two lectures. So, we have a quantum field theory for which in the UV there could be a Lagrangian description or non-Lagrangian description by some string theory construction. So, for example, if Lagrangian description, then, as we talked last time, the Lagrangian can be specified by saying what is the gauge group G. So that would be compact Lie group. And the flavor symmetry group. And the representation of G time F, for which we take as a representation for the hypermultiplet. So R is G times F, quaternionic representation. There are other possible non-Lagrangian constructions from string theory, which I don't write here, but you need to keep that in mind. Now, to this UV quantum field theory, we associate the infrared field theory at the low energies. And concretely, here we'll consider only Coulomb branch of the modular space of vacua, which I'll call in this lecture U. Since conveniently, I mean customarily, the points in this Coulomb branch of vacua is usually called U variables or U plane. So that the infrared theory is the theory, this nonlinear sigma model for the space of maps from the space-time to the space U. And we can add several more data on which I will expand, namely, as you'll see today, this space U actually comes with a vibration of abelian varieties of Earth, so that the total space of this vibration, P over U, is complex integrable system. Okay, now, given that complex integrable system, we can ask questions, well, classical questions, but as well we can ask questions about quantization of that quantum integrable system, of the classical integrable system, while the classical integrable system is just associated to d equals 4 and equals 2 theory, full quantum theory, but in the low energy limit, there should be some deformation of the theory which corresponds to the quantum deformation of the classical integrable system. So that deformation has been identified. And now, given quantization of that integrable system, we can consider the algebra that corresponds to the algebra of quantum observables. So let me call it A. So algebra that quantizes. Say the space of functions for that quantum integrable system, the algebra of operators. So on the one hand. And finally, there is a connection between this algebra and the original UV theory that we have started from, at least in certain BPS or so-called cohomological sector of this theory. So there is a relation in the Q cohomologies of the original UV theory. So this picture is a plan for the rest of the talk, and I will explain the corners of this diagram and various examples. Okay, other questions about the diagram? Yes.
Okay, so the theory is a point in U.
The low energy theory is the space of maps from the space-time to the U. So a point of U is a vacua of the theory. And if you consider low energy approximation, then we can have that vacua slowly vary with the space-time. So the low energy theory is let's write it. So the low energy theory, the QFT, well, classical QFT that you have here, as this is the Abelian theory, the low energy theory, it's the space of maps from the space-time R31 to the U plane.
It will write equation for motions, Euler equations.
Will we write?
Effective action.
Yes. I write it, yes. Just in a second. It's just an Abelian theory, yes. Other questions?
What was the symbol that you put? You put A as an algebra that quantizes like C of P or something?
Yes, the algebra of functions on P.
Yeah, it's maybe that mathematicians do not usually of in okay. Of P, yeah,
C. Well, okay.
You mean kind of polynomial functions here?
Well, I don't want to go into the precise details, but I just want to give an idea. So here we have a classical system. The phase space is a symplectic space, so it has a space of functions. Yes, everything will be holomorphic, but up to now, just to see the conceptual relation, you need to keep in mind that here we are dealing with a finite dimensional integrable system of classical mechanics, and here we consider its quantization, and we have the algebra which quantizes the algebra of quantum operators. And then there is magically, well, not so magically after you close this diagram, a relation between this algebra and the original UV theory that we have.
And the quantization parameter, what does it mean if it's...
Yes, and the quantization parameter, well, it would be identified depending on how precisely we'll do the quantization. But, let me add the detail right now. So if you do this quantization in what is called complex structure I, but I will explain it later, complex structure I, holomorphic quantization, with parameter h bar, then it would correspond to the deformation of the theory by taking it on R4 with respect to SO4 equivariant action, and you set one of the two parameters of the SO4 equivariant action, which are usually called epsilon Nekrasov's parameters, to h bar. So epsilon 1 is h bar, epsilon 2 is 0. So that's the literature is called Nekrasov-Shitashvili deformation of n equals 2 theory. I will explain on it. Other questions? Okay, now, so let us first consider, okay, it's step by step. First of all, the classical picture. So why n equals 2 theory, d equals 4, n equals 2 theory, corresponds in the infrared to the integrable system. So for this, the most important point to understand is electric-magnetic duality of the four-dimensional theories. So let's make it very clear. Of course, it starts from your high school or have a middle school where you know that you can exchange electric and magnetic field, and you can exchange electric and magnetic charges. Let me label the charges N electric and N magnetic. And all equations of motion of Maxwell would stay the same, well, if you assume the existence of magnetic charges, which haven't been really observed in the nature. But formally, it's the symmetry of the equations of motions of abelian Maxwell theory. Like if you replace all electrons by monopoles and imagine that you have monopoles running by currents in the wires, then still everything would hold the same. So we don't. So it's just so far when we labeled electrons by electrons, not the monopoles, we've chosen just a convention in the abelian theory. Okay, so which one? E, B, and E, and M.
This is N E.
N sub E, the number. I mean, the electric charge, integer. Okay. The integer number for electric charge, the integer number for magnetic charge. We'll label the charges by integers. Okay, now let's discuss it concretely. And let's do the case of U1 to the R abelian theory. So for U1 to the R abelian theory, we can label the curvature of the gauge connection. So F would be curvature. And let me label it by Fi, where I runs from 1 to r, for each of these u1 to the r factors. Now, so this the Young-Mill section can be written as I over 4 pi, integral over 4 manifold, fi, which tau ij prime, Fij minus square root of minus 1. We'll use this symbol. tau ij 2 primes star of Fj. So what are these guys? Well, this is a generalization for the rank R case of the Young-Mills action for U1 theory, which you write simply as 1 over g squared Young-Mills. F, which F, F star, sorry, F, which star F, that's absolute value of F squared, and plus theta coupling, or which counts C2, so plus F, which F, the topological term with the coupling theta over 2 pi. Okay, and then it's convenient to combine 4 pi over g squared Young-Mills plus theta over 2 pi into the complexified coupling constant, which we call tau. So this is in the complex plane. And the real and imaginary part of the complexified coupling constant we'll denote by tau prime and tau 2 primes. So this is imaginary part. It corresponds to 1 over g squared. And the real part corresponds to theta over 2 pi. OK? So you see that in these conventions, the coupling constant, I mean, the coupling constant on the Young-Mills theory or Maxwell theory, 1 over g squared, it corresponds to imaginary part of tau, and that's how we write it here. So F wedge star F couples with the imaginary part of matrix tau ij, and F wedge F couples with the real part of matrix tau ij, and the matrix tau ij is here, matrix tau ij is symmetric N times N matrix. And we also want this part, the part which defines equations of motion, the electric the Maxwell action to be positive definite, 1 over g squared Young Mills needs to be positive. And so we'll ask imaginary part of tau ij to be positive definite. Okay, so which means that tau is in what's called the Siegel upper half plane of n times n symmetric matrices. So which would be almost, which would be related to the modular space of abelian varieties, to which we'll come in a second. Okay, so the first one is that one, yes. Is square root of minus 1. Oh, did I put, yes, I put in this.
In which signature are we?
This is Euclidean signature. This is.
It would be real imaginary. Because there are two eyes. You put also an eye in front of our
development. Yes, I put, I'm sorry, let me put an eye here. Maybe I didn't. Okay, in Euclidean signature, you need to put an I in front of the theta coupling term. So I put an I here because I and that I with the imaginary part of coupling constant combined just to 1 over g squared Young-Mills. And the real part of coupling constant, which is theta parameter, it comes with the I factor. Mm-hmm, thank you. Okay. So let's consider the equations of motion of this theory. So first of all, if we consider the electric charge, so electric charge contributes just by the Wilson line, so that would be integral over the trajectory of electric charge. So this is one contour, one-dimensional contour, and you integrate minus I and I AI, where NI is the electric charge. So N in the Z to R electric charge. So if you solve the equations of motion, like just add the thing to the action and extremize the variation of S, set delta S to 0, delta of S Young-Mills plus S source, let me call it S source, plus 0.
And AI is a potential corresponding to FI?
Exactly, yes, yes, yes. AI is the connection, one form corresponding to the curvature FI. Yes, so let's extremize it, and then we find that I over 2 pi delta AI, which D of tau AJ prime FJ minus I tau AJ 2 primes star of FJ is equal to, let me erase that. Is equal to I and I, the integral of delta I. Okay, and if you set the variation to 0 for every delta I, it implies that that 1 over 2 pi d of this combination of tau ij prime fj minus I tau ij 2 primes star of j is just an I gamma tilde, where for, so this is a two form, the differential of the three form, and by gamma tilde I mean the three form which is supported by delta function supported on the contour gamma. So in other words, Hodge dual to the contour gamma. Okay, now solving this equation with the source, clearly we have the solution which goes like 1 over square, the foremost Coulomb law, but we'd like to write it in as a Gauss law, namely the flux. So we see that 1 over 2 pi, the integral over 2 sphere, the 2 sphere which links with this contour gamma over tau ij prime minus I tau ij 2 primes star fj is equal to an I. Okay? So this is the condition on the field strength. Oops, I missed fj here. Okay, so there is a combination of fj and the Hodge dual of f with the imaginary part of the complex constant. And the flux of this total combination, so you can think about it as electric field and this is a magnetic field, this flux is equal to ni. So this is what electric charge creates. Now, for the magnetic charge, it's electric charge.
So the boundary of S2 is a cycle gamma?
S2 links to gamma.
Dual.
Links. It's linked. Gamma is one cycle in four-dimensional space-time, and S2 surrounds it. So in three dimensions, gamma reduces just to a point, which evolves with time, and S2 is the sphere which surrounds the charge. And this is Gauss' law. The total flux of electric field strengths around the S2 is the charge. But in the presence of that theta parameter, there is a shift. So there is a certain combination, concretely, which is written here, of electric and magnetic field, which is created by the electric charge. Okay, so for magnetic charge, well, magnetic charge is, we don't have to do any computation. Magnetic charge is just topological configuration associated to non-trivial C1 of this gauge connection, which means that 1 over 2 pi of Fi itself integrated over the 2 sphere is Mi. And now let me call actually. No. This is S2 which links contour. S2 linked with gamma. And that gamma is supports magnetic charge, and that's what that equation means. So I call it, okay. So on that blackboard, I call electric charge simply by Ni and magnetic charge by Mi. Okay. Electric, magnetic. Okay, so given a configuration with the electric charge on some contour, we have electric and magnetic field which satisfy this flux condition. Given magnetic charge, we have electric and magnetic field which satisfy this flux condition. Yes, in principle, you can put them on the same contour and
same
have a
same
dyne.
Contour?
Yes.
For the moment, you have only one contour.
For the moment, I have one contour, yes. But we'll go in just to allow any number of contours. This is a local condition that, you know, the flux around S2 for a given contour doesn't depend on what happens and away from that S2. Yes. So now, what is electric magnetic duality? So electric magnetic duality is almost what I've been told in school. You just switch electric and magnetic charges. Yes, but now let's make it more precise. Actually, so since we have now a lattice of electric and magnetic charges, so we have Z to the 2R lattice, in which we've chosen the basis. In that presentation, we decided that we have splitted that lattice into ZR plus ZR, and elements here we called electric, and elements here we've called magnetic. Now, for the case of lattice of rank R, you would just switch N and M. And if you keep track of the signs, that switch is implemented by antisymmetric matrix. That would be a transformation for R equals 1. that implements electromagnetic duality. So more generally, the condition on the new electric and magnetic charges, which I called tilde, expressed in terms of the old one by some matrix of transformation. So let me call it actually. Yes. So let me call that matrix gamma. And the condition is that the symplectic pairing of electric and magnetic charges should stay the same. And it follows from the quantization of moment, namely, angular momentum. Namely, if you consider a configuration with electric charge and magnetic charge, then you can compute that the total angular momentum, which is created by that configuration, a pair of dynes, would be given. So if you take one dyne with the charge and m, and another dyne with charge and tilde, m tilde, and compute angular momentum, of the configuration, you find that it's proportional to this symplectic combination. Okay, and that should be integer by the Dirac-Lo quantization condition of the spin. So it means that this lattice z to the r is equipped with a symplectic form. There is a symplectic form. Yes?
Yes. Yeah, you should have some loops, yeah, and contours, yeah,
so
you should put the charges.
Yes. So here I'm taking two contours, which just run in time, and they are located at some two special
locations. Yeah, rotate on the
yes.
Rotations in three dimensions.
Rotations in three dimensions, yes. You compute the angular momentum of the field configurations for rotations in three dimensions. It's just classical calculation. You just take f and b.
Yeah, what does that calculate called angular momentum?
Well, angular momentum of a field, you know, the electric field has a momentum, that pointing vector, fb. And it's totally classical computation. No. In the space-time, you have just two points. Yes. And you compute the angular momentum for the rotation around the axis which connects these two points. Yes. So a pair of two dynes, it has angular momentum. And it should be a half integer. Well, the normalization is chosen in such a way that actually this combination is integer. Okay, so we want, after the duality transformation, that angular momentum to be the same. So it means that we want to preserve the symplectic form on the lattice of electromagnetic charges. And, well, it means that this transformation gamma is actually is inside integral symplectic group. So gamma is...
By the way, maybe your notation is...
Yes.
N prime, M prime, it's not the same until the here you have really...
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, so let's fix notations. Let's put primes here, just for two dynes, yes? Yes, okay. And here I'm discussing the transformation which implements electromagnetic duality. Duality transformation. When you have an M, go to N tilde, M tilde. Yes. Yes. Exactly. So the new F, exactly. So the new Fs should be linear combinations of the off. Of the old Fs as well as new charges are linear combinations of what. So exactly that's what we want to do now. Yes. So okay. So gamma is in the symplectic group. Okay. So let me call maybe here some element the group of the group gamma, and gamma should be a subgroup of, well, here I've chosen the symplectic form in such a way which corresponds to what's called principal polarization of abelian varieties that will come in a second. And so in this presentation, gamma is just SP of 2R valued in integers. Yes, the group of 2R by 2R matrices, which preserve the symplectic form corresponding to this formula. In the matrix notation, it would be 1, 0, R times R matrix, minus 1, R times R matrix, 0. And G is an element of gamma, and let me write G as the block matrix A, B, C, D. So A, B, C, D are R by R matrices. Okay. Maybe I like to keep it. So I'll go. Okay. Okay, indeed. Now we want to make a linear transformation which expresses new F tilde and star of F tilde in terms of the old F and star of F. And so for that, it's convenient to introduce matrix tau ij. So it's a matrix valued operator which acts on the two forms. Yes. On R tuple of two forms, so R to the R. On the space-time. And let me define tau ij as follows. It would be the real part of the matrix tau ij, tau minus I, the imaginary part of the matrix tau ij, two primes, with the Hodge star. Okay, so when you act by this operator on a field configuration, you get a new field configuration. So now, why did I choose that combination? Just to have a convenient way to capture the equation for the electric charge and for the magnetic charge. So here's the equation for the electric charge, and somewhere I had the one for the magnetic charge. Yes, which was over there, 1/2 pi Fi = mi. So okay, using this capital T, let's write just our equations. So the equations would be that the integral over S2, yes, of 2 pi tau ij fj or ni and the integral of Fi is Mi. Okay, and now we want to switch to a new combination of tilde and F tilde in such a way that tau ij, Tij tilde
the greater acting of the tensor product with u and I and j. It's a predicated just in forms. It's multiplication.
Yes, I want. Okay, but I mean it's the matrix of it acts on it.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me. Okay, and the Tij is the matrix of that thing. The matrix of T. Okay, so it's operator-valued matrix. Okay, so we want to find the new electric and magnetic fields, and correspondingly, we want to find a new coupling constant, tau, which I will call tau tilde, and I will capture the tau tilde in the operator tau ij tilde. So after the duality transformation, we want to have the equations like tau tilde ij, f tilde j is an I, and equations that f tilde I is mi tilde. Okay, so that would be EM duality. Okay, so how we do that? Well, so since we have expressed the n tilde and m tilde, n tilde m tilde as ABCD, sorry, acting on MM, and you make that linear transformation and request for those equations, and then you find that F tilde needs to be given by C T plus D. So here I just multiply R times R matrices. And T is operator valued, so it has a Hodge star included in it. Okay, on F. And the new tau tilde is AT plus B times CT plus D to minus 1. So you maybe should ask, how do I do the inversion of this operator since T has a Hodge star in it? Well, actually, algebraically, it's easy because the Hodge star squares to 1. And so if you want to compute because we are in Euclidean, yes. Otherwise, it would square to minus 1, and then I wouldn't write that imaginary unit in front of it. So anyways, what stands in front of tau ij 2 primes squares to minus 1. Okay, so, and since it squares to minus 1, then when you compute the inverse of that operator, you just take that tau as a complex matrix and compute inverse of it, and then again use it with the notation of the Hodge star. In the Ziegler, exactly. So now we are came to the main point. So after electric magnetic duality, after such transformation, tau changes as so said. So it's a tau plus b over c tau plus d to minus 1, and it means that we are in the quotient of the Siegel upper half plane by the gamma which is the sp value, gamma is integral symplectic group acting on 2r dimensional lattice with that canonical symplectic form.
Does the selective quantity derivative make sense on not on flat space time but on arbitrary manifold?
Yes. So here I never used actually the structure of the flat space time.
So this is still good kind of global quantization parameters, so we get kind of second homology, integral of second homology relative to integer, yeah? And that divergent transformation is a result, yeah? Because it's star f, it's just not
integral. No. After duality transformation,
you integrate only around S2 around, yes. But in the global space time, you can have different S2 which is not surround. Like if you take CP2,
yes.
Then it will be another kind of global homology classes which you can.
So arm should not be intervector vector, a vector with components in some commodity space. What you said?
No. Suppose you don't have any controls at all. Yeah, but closed manifold.
Yes.
Then you have a condition: the integral of curvature over some closed cycle should be integer. Yeah. And if we make Dirichlet, we don't have any other tangent constraints at all, yeah?
Well, but after duality transformation, I would integrate over such other clause, the two cycles, the f tilde, and it would be integral.
Ah, the common class of
f should be integral.
No, f is integral, but it's a duality transformation, or just?
Yes, again f is integral. F tilde is integral. F is integral as well as f tilde is integral.
And your matrix.
So that thing has hedge operator in it, but this is integral. Yes, t is not integral, but t includes hedge operator and so on. So this is
but you integrate not around S2 surrounding.
Okay. So when you want to integrate about on S2 which surrounds some non-trivial cycles, you take only on the last lines.
Yeah, but there are other S2s, for example, here, space-time is CP2.
Sure. So for
this CP2, you don't have, this integrality will be broken, right? I understand.
No. For the other CP2s, you just integrate F tilde, and F tilde is still integral.
No, because you see that F tilde is AT plus B multiplied, OCT plus B multiplied by F.
Mm-hmm.
B is integer, but t is some complex numbers, yeah? T is integers, but t is some complex numbers.
Right, but so f tilde, okay, so f tilde, it has, yes, tau, which acts on it, and also it includes some combination of f and Hodge of f. Yes, and Hodge of F is created by electric charges. And so it has 1 over tau on it. So after all, after this transformation, the F tilde is integral on H2.
No, it's not charges. I consider just closed space-time.
Okay, well, so
it's some quantization condition.
It should be quantization condition both on F and F star, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
right.
So it's maybe visible only after quantum sealing, not really in classical.
Okay, other questions? Okay, so here is the bottom line, the main point. The main point is that the electric charge is not actually what we've been told in school. It's not just a number. Okay, this Compley constant is not just a number. But in fact, this is a point in the modular space of the upper half plane mod gamma, and we can identify that with the modular space over Nkr polarized abelian varieties. Principally polarized abelian varieties. Okay, so that's the main point.
It's because you have R different electromagnetic fields.
Yes.
Your abelian field is U1 to U1.
U1 to the R, exactly. Yes. Okay, so you want the R coupling constant tau. You should think about this tau as tau is principally polarized abelian variety of Rankine. So that's how we should describe Maxwell theory, not by number, but by abelian variety. And that's how connection to the integral system immediately would appear in Zweig-Witten theory.
But tau and tau double polar coupling constant properly. A properly coupling constant.
Properly coupling constant, yes.
Yes. Tau prime and tau double prime.
Yes.
They play the role of coupling constant.
Yes. So they play a role of coupling constant, but there is no a priori choice of the basis. Okay. So
this is modular space of whatever this, I think it will be conformal series, yeah.
Yes.
It will be this H mod gamma,
yeah. They would be parameterized by H mod gamma. Yes. Okay, so now let's, okay. So naively, if you choose basis in the lattice of electromagnetic charges, so if you choose what we call electric, what we call magnetic, then we have a period matrix tau ij of abelian variety, yes, and this period matrix tau ij is the coupling constant. But the choice of basis is not forced on us, so we just should think invariantly that the coupling constant of U1 to the R theory is abelian variety itself. And then we don't need to specify the basis, yes? Okay, now recall that in the last lecture we've discussed that if you start from UV theory with gauge group G of rank R, then the potential for the scalars has the term like phi bar squared, and that means that in the infrared the theory flows to U1 to the R abelian theory. And the eigenvalues are the field which parameterizes the abelian configuration, phi computing with phi bar, was called AI. So phi is AI, where AI labeled some, okay, the coordinates in some basis. Of the algebra, just U1 to the R, yes, complexified. Okay. C to the R. So the coupling constant tau ij in this special coordinates AI is a special coordinates on the modular space of vector U, and tau ij is the second derivative of the prepotential function. That is implied by n equals to supersymmetry. Symmetry implies that the coupling constant is the second derivative of the holomorphic prepotential. Function on U. Okay. And the action, the low energy action for this U1 abelian theory is what? Well, it's tau ij, some function of A on the modular space of vacua. And then it's just exactly that action that I've written for the abelian theory, but then deleted. So we have tau ij prime Fi which of j minus tau ij 2 primes fi wedge hodge fj. Tau ij now is a function of A. Yes, on the modular space of vacuum. With an I, yes. And with an integral over the four-dimensional manifold. And also an I in front of tau ij. Did I have an I here? Yes, thank you. Yes, I did. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have a family of theories, of abelian theories, which are parameterized by the modular space of vacua, this calligraphic U. And the coupling constant for that abelian theory is abelian variety, as we discussed. It's not just a matrix. It's a matrix modulo that SP to RZ transformation. That means it's an abelian variety itself. So that means that we have a vibration over the U plane and let me hang over each point of the module space of vector that abelian variety, which I called A. So the fiber is rank R. Abelian variety. So this space is complex dimension R.
And does it converge to this? Are these abelian varieties is kind of given base point zero or?
Yes, it would be given base point in a second. Yes, yes. So the P is the total space of this vibration. The complex dimension of the base of the modular space of vector is R. The complex dimension of the abelian variety is R as well. So let me, maybe I'm using this terminology, abelian variety, but if there are some students unfamiliar, so abelian variety for us is a quotient of C to the R by the full lattice. And if you've chosen a basis of cycles here in H1 of A in the dual pairing, like alpha I, which alpha j is 0, beta I, which beta j is 0, and alpha I, beta j is delta ij. And then you pick R holomorphic differentials, let's call it just dzi, and when you integrate dzi over alpha cycles, you get delta ij. When you integrate dzi over beta cycles, you get tau ij. So tau ij is a complex matrix. Now, what I've said so far is just a complex torus. Now, for it to be actually defined by algebraic equations in some projective space by Riemann conditions, you need this matrix tau to be symmetric and positive definite. And that's exactly the same condition that we have on the coupling constant of electromagnetic theory of abelian theory. Okay, so here we have
for one form.
Well, it's just a flat space. It's one of the coordinates here in C to the R. Good. So the total space, as you see, is 2R complex dimensional. Yes. So P is the total space of this vibration. So at each point of the module space of vector, we attach a complex torus of complex dimension R, that abelian variety, and P is the total space of the thing, the total space of this vibration.
Of family with R complex.
Of the families. Yes, of the families of tori fibered over the module space of vector. Because at each point on the module space of vector, we have a coupling constant tau up to the transformation.
Tau j.
Yes,
tau j
this
j
one.
J.
Yes. Exactly. So tau ij at some point u, for u in the module space of vector, is the tau ij of the abelian variety A at the point u.
Infrared
degeneration.
Are we in the sector of infrared?
Yes.
It's infrared limit. Yes, it's infrared description.
Ah, and then you get profound field theory, which is kind of abelian, depends on your vacuum.
Yes. It's an abelian Maxwell theory you want to the R, which depends on the vacuum. Yes. So at each point, you have an abelian theory, and then you can have that theory slowly varying with a point on space-time, and that gives nonlinear sigma model. So this is an infrared Zyberg-Witten theory.
Yeah,
Okay, but okay, it's parameterized by this family of abelian varieties over the module space of Loki. So let's discuss more geometry of that vibration, which comes from and close to supersymmetry. Well, it just comes from this condition. Remember that tau ij is not an arbitrary matrix valued function on a module space of Loki, but it has to come the second derivative of a prepotential function in some coordinates, in this special coordinates. So let's write that equation. F is complex valued, yes, yes. And tau is complex. Yes, tau is complex valued, and tau is complex valued, tau is symmetric, and the imaginary part of tau is positive definite, and it means that the base space U is special Keller. We discussed it last time. So the Keller prepotential is imaginary part of AI bar DIF, special color manifold. Okay, so let me introduce dual coordinates. I call it BI, dual coordinates on U plane. So BI are gonna be just derivative of that prepotential function F. Yes, and since we have the BI that dj of bi is tau ij. Yes, so we can write it in terms of the differential one forms. So in terms of one forms, you have the relation that dbi one forms on U. Have the relation that dbi is tau ij DAJ, yes? Okay, now. Okay, so now let's choose let's consider this vibration E to P over U, and represent this differential dai. So it should be an integration of the holomorphic one form along the vertical directions of this vibration, so along this complex story. And since we've taken differential of it, then the differential should be represented by integration over the alpha I cycles on fibers, yes, of some two form. So let's call this form omega. So this is the one form on the base on U. This is a two form in the total space, and dai is a integration of the two form over one cycle, which gives one form on the base. Okay. So similar dbi is integral over beta I. Of omega. And well, if you like to expand that formula in terms of some coordinates U on the U plane, then it would be that
bi is just df by dai locally.
Excuse me?
Bi is df by dai locally.
Bi is the yes. So the relation
F is a function, not a field.
F is a function. Yes, yes, yes. I'm using curly letter F here, yes. It's a function on the module space of vacuum. A function on the module space of vacuum U, whose Hessian, whose second derivative, gives us the coupling constant tau. So this comes just from the fact that the fiber, the abelian variety, has the period matrix tau ij. And since dbi related to tau ij to dij, we can find the two-form, holomorphic two-form, such that the differential is given by this equation. Yes. Okay. Now, the condition that tau ij is actually a derivative, dIdjf, this implies that the two-form omega is closed, of d omega 0. And locally, so there should exist one form lambda on the total space P. And this form lambda is called Zabier-Kwitten one form. Such that AR is integral over cycle alpha I of the one form lambda, and BI is integral over cycle beta I of the one form lambda. Okay. And lambda
beta generator is topological.
Yes. Alpha and beta are generators of the H1 of the abelian variety. Yes. So d lambda is omega. It's called in the literature of Zabier-Kwitten integrable system, Zabier-Kwitten one form in the literature on just integrable system. This is Liouville form. So Liouville Zabier-Kwitten. It in one form on the total space, on the phase space. So I already said the word integrable system. Well, why that? Okay, we have almost all ingredients. We have two R complex dimensional space P, equipped with the two form. This is holomorphic 2,0 holomorphic form. We call it omega, and this is holomorphic symplectic structure. Okay. From the construction, it follows that this projection is actually Lagrangian. So the fibers AU are Lagrangian with respect to omega, yes. Okay, so it means that if you consider the algebra of functions on P and compute the Poisson bracket, then the functions U, which are functions here, they commute. And so the vibration makes this geometry to have the structure of integrable system.
Complex.
It's complex integrable system. Yes, so this is holomorphic, complex, integrable system.
U is, actually, U is an algebraic variety, right? Because it's a spectrum of chiral wind, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's kind of finite.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it's not finite, but actually algebraic.
Yes. Yes, and also the fibers, they are abelian varieties, not generic or complex story, but abelian varieties. So yes. So you can say that it's actually an algebraic integrable system. Okay, let's make a short break for 3 minutes. Okay, let's start the second part. Okay, so the conclusion of the first part was that to each n equals to four-dimensional theory in the infrared for its Coulomb branch of vacuum, where the gauge group is broken down to U1 to the R, where R was the rank of the gauge group in the UV. So to each such theory, we associate algebraic integrable system. So we've explained that link. Okay, now let me discuss one example of it, and mentioned the construction, mentioned the notion of Zyber-Quinton curve. So that's how originally it appeared. Well, the idea is, well, it's chronologically it's reversed order, but the idea is that the Jacobian, well, for some, in simplest case, simple case, you consider a vibration, a family of curves, sigma over U plane, the modular space of vacuum, and you just ask it to be to. You construct it in such a way that a Jacobian of a curve sigma attached to a given point U in the modular space of vacuum is the abelian variety A to U. And so for the rank R theory, you would take sigma U, sigma to be a family of genus R curves. Genus R curves over U. Okay, so let me give the simplest example of that. It is the following. In the four dimensions n equals to theory, you take Lagrangian theory with the group G is SU2 and trivial Flaveler group. And so trivial or empty representation for the hypermultiplet. The simplest non-abelian theory you can imagine. So I'm not going to derive the answer, but let me just present it right now to have an example. So the answer for this theory is the following. You have the U plane. Which is equivalent to the C. And classically, the C comes with the coordinate U, which is a trace of phi squared. So it's A squared classically. Because remember that we identified the classical modular space of vacuum with the Lie algebra, with the complexified Lie algebra of the gauge group. So it would be T of SU2, which is C, but mod the Weyl group, which is Z2. And so the natural coordinate on C mod Z2, if coordinate on C is A, the coordinate on C mod Z2 would be A squared, and that's called U. So the the space of values of U is U plane, and this is the modular space of vacuum. Okay, now at to each point of this modular space of vacuum, we attach an abelian variety of rank 1, and rank 1 abelian variety is just an elliptic curve. And so it's Jacobian of elliptic curve is elliptic curve itself. So here the distinction doesn't matter with construction by curves or construction by abelian varieties. Anyways, the Zyber-Quinton curve, sigma curve or abelian variety AU is, I will describe it by equations in the two-dimensional space, and this curve in the C2 with coordinates xy. Actually, it's a little bit more natural describe it not in C2, but C times C star with the coordinate x and coordinate y by the equation y plus 1 over y equals to x squared minus u. So this is an elliptic curve. If you express y in terms of x solving quadratic equation, you'll get a square root. So on the x-plane, it's x-plane. There are four branch points. These four branch points correspond to the vanishing of the discriminant. So let me denote the right-hand side of this equation by t of x. Okay, so if you solve the quadratic equation, you'll get square root of t of x squared minus 4. This is a polynomial of the fourth order, because four zeros. And this is the branch points of the curve. And so you have two covering of the x-plane, branching of the second order at each of these points. It makes it elliptic curve. If you want to draw a picture with the two sheets, it would be like that. The upper sheet, and then the tube, which connect the cuts that you can make between those branch points. And here is the lower sheet. And so this is the genus 1 curve. This is one cycle, and that would be the dual cycle. Like this is a cycle which you would call cycle alpha, and cycle like that would be called cycle beta. So there is a two-form, closed two-form on the total space. The total space P, the phase space P, you can say that can parameterize it locally by the coordinates u for the coordinates on the base, and say coordinate x, which would be a local coordinate on the curve x. Y is expressed in terms of x by the equation. So ux are local coordinates here, x is local coordinate here, and u is local coordinate here. The Zieber-Quitten 1 form is the following. Lambda is dx, is x dy over y, so that the coordinate functions a and b, the special coordinate functions, are the functions on the module space of vector, are given by the integral of this one form lambda, respectively over alpha cycle of that elliptic curve, dy over y, and the beta cycle. Okay, and if you compute explicitly, that leads to a certain hypergeometric functions, the integrals of square roots of polynomials of fourth order leads to elliptic integrals. So that's the simplest example for such a Zieber-Quitten integrable system. Is it clear? Now, if you think about this integrable system as mechanics, so you'd like to identify it with something familiar, and the identification is that this is two particle closed Todor chain. Which means that you have the phase space P and phi with the symplectic form dp to d phi, just a rank one system. And the Hamiltonian is e to phi, the Hamiltonian h is e to the phi plus e to minus phi let's say p squared minus e to the phi plus e to the minus phi. Okay, and I want to identify it with this equation. So I think about p as x and e to the phi as y. So x as p and e to the phi is y. And then the Hamiltonian, the function on this total space of x and p is this, is the u plane, the u variable. Okay. So that Hamiltonian is the Hamiltonian of the closed order chain for two particles in which we factored out the mass. So it's just Cauchy potential.
And the Cauchy is the wrong sign.
Yes. So remember, everything here was complex. Everything here is complex. So when you want to put a real structure, you just put I and here, and you can put that in different manners. And you can, there is a flexibility to make a real integrable system from complex integrable system by choosing the real contour of integration. Okay, is this example clear? Yes.
You need to assign some boundary condition from that to the chain system.
Yeah, so here is a closed Todor chain, so there are no boundary conditions. It's a system of two particles, yes? So the two particles, if you call the coordinates of those two particles phi 1 and phi 2, the potential would be e to the phi 1 minus phi 2 plus e to phi 2 minus phi 1. But I factored out the integral of motion for the center mass and called the difference phi.
In the same for p.
And the same for p, yes. P is the difference between momentum of the two particle and the common momentum, the sum of the two momentums is factored out for the motion of the center of mass. Okay, so this is a two particle close to the chain factored out the total momentum.
Phi is not an angle.
Phi, not necessarily. I mean, you can make it, you can think about it as an angle in the I direction because this is a periodic thing. Yes, but not necessarily. So again, that depends on the choice of real structure. You can think it is a Todor system on a real line or is a Todor system on the circle, and that would give different quantizations of the system. Other questions? Okay. Okay, so after the simplest example, now let's go from the other side and try to think out the most generic integrable system possible, which appear in relation to n equals 2d equals 4 gauge theories. Well, it seems that the relevant construction that actually captures all examples we've seen so far is a Mukai, a certain sub-construction of the Mukai construction for holomorphic symplectic spaces. Okay, so first of all, we need to have a holomorphic symplectic space P. Yes, so how do we get it? Well, the suggestion is the following. You take a symplectic surface that's called S, and you consider the modular space of holomorphic G bundles. Maybe better to say holomorphic principle G shifts on S, and it turns out that this space is holomorphic symplectic space. So the holomorphic symplectic structure on S naturally induces the holomorphic symplectic structure on the modular space of G shifts on F on S.
dimension of S?
Surface, 2. Complex dimension 2. Complex dimension 2. Holomorphic symplectic surface. So, yes. So, complex dimension of S is 2. And physicists actually like to think about this construction. Actually, I think physicists had it earlier, but in math it's called Mukha. In physics literature, there is no name except maybe from Rochick and Friends paper about hyperkeller quotient. So, physicists think about it as following. You take a hyperkeller space. Hyperkeller space S. And you consider on the hyperkeller space the modulus space of solutions to self-dual equations. F plus 0, where F is the curvature for a connection for a principal G bundle. For G bundle on S. So this is just self-dual instantons. S, and as we reviewed, I think, in the first lecture, their self-dual equations, F plus equals 0, they provide the hyperkeller reduction of the space of all connections. And so the resulting space is naturally has natural hyperkeller structure as well. Okay, so the modular space of instantons on the hyperkeller space viewed in one of complex structures is the modular space of holomorphic G bundles on the surface S. And that holomorphic structure is one of holomorphic complex structures with a specific choice from that hyperkeller structureness. Well, anyways, so that's the idea for where we get holomorphic symplectic space P. Now, for integrable system, we actually need to have a vibration P to U. So then we need to be something more specific. So let's consider this example. So the first example is when for P, we take T star to C, where C is complex curve. So T star of C is natural holomorphic symplectic space with a canonical symplectic form dp dq, where p is the coordinate in the fiber and q is the coordinate in the base. And then you consider... Yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you, S. S is T star of C. And then you consider the modular space of sheaves, which have a support, so G sheaves, with support.
Does it make sense to speak about G sheaves and not? Yeah.
Why not?
No, there's really no sense in it yet. You have coherent sheaves, but since the structure group of the orthogonal or the E8 makes no sense.
Well, I'm not sure. Forgive me, but...
Yeah, okay. Why don't you see bundle?
But because I want to have a support on C.
It's really not a bundle, but it should be supported on a curve, yeah.
Okay.
Well, maybe it's not defined in math precise sense, but I want you to use it. So... Okay, so then, keep just in mind example of GLR, and so this is equivalent to the Hitchin system.
Curves with support not on C but on spectral curve, shift on the surface.
No, it's supported on C. On spectral curve, we have a support just of a line bundle. It would come from...
The support, what does it mean? G shifts on what? G shifts on surface?
On S.
On S?
This is G shifts on S, yes. With support on C.
On zero section.
On zero section,
are you sure?
I think so.
I mean, the normal pitches have the support on the spectral curve.
You normally get this line bundle which supports the spectral curve.
Yes, but you get line bundle. After you construct the spectral curve. But I mean, if you start from the Hitchin system itself.
Yes. You can see the board the space board.
Okay. Okay. Let me write it here. So a Hitchin system would be G bundles. G bundles, the pair of a G bundle on C and the section phi of a joint of G and the tensor canonical bundle. Yes, so this is T star of C. So if you don't like this, okay, so take this definition. So the modular space of G bundles, there is no spectral curve here. Just the modular space of G bundles and holomorphic section, joint valued holomorphic section in T star of C. And I think about this data as the modular space of G bundles which are supported on a zero section C of T star of C. So that was a complex algebraic complex description. Let me give you here hypercalor description. So for hypercalor description, you consider G bundles with the connection A on C for a compact group G and the section phi of one form. So it's one form omega 1. And that there the Lie algebra of G. And the equations that A and phi satisfy are the following: Fa minus phi, which phi is 0, dA star phi is 0, dA phi is 0. So this is the three-moment maps. And the quotient, the hypercalor quotient of this hypercalor space by these equations gives the hypercalor modular space. So this hypercalor modular space is called the modular space of Hitchin system. It's possible to enlarge this construction by taking C to be equipped with some number of marked points. And consider the modular space of such G bundles with a holomorphic section, where the structure group is reduced parabolic reduction at marked points. Okay. I don't want to go to further details, just to give an idea. So that's one example. Yes, but for this example, I need to finish with the explanation of what is the projection. So for that, let's write down what spectral curve is. So you can parameterize the Hitchin modular space as follows. So take that Higgs field and consider the spectrum of that Higgs field in some representation. So for now, let me take the example GLR Hitchin system. So I pick fundamental representation of GLR and take the determinant in this representation of phi minus t. So then you get R sections of T star of C corresponding to the roots or the eigenvalues of phi. And that means that you have a R-fold, a fold cover, which I called C. Let me call it sigma of C inside T star C. So there is the spectral curve sigma. There is the base curve C. There is R fold cover. There is a projection pi. And then you take a line bundle on sigma. Yes, and you push forward that line bundle by this projection P and get Roncar bundle E on C. Okay, so the modular space of Hitchin system then is the modular space of such cover sigma with the modular space of line bundles on sigma. So that makes it to the structure of vibration that we wanted. There is A to P over U vibration, and U comes, U is the space of spectral curves, of spectral covers, R cover sigma to C. And for a given spectral cover sigma at the point U, A sub U would be the Jacobian of the modular space of line bundles L on sigma. So this is Jacobian of sigma sub U. Other questions?
So the example which is here matches up with, is this the Hitchin system on an elliptic curve with one marked point?
Was it original, I'm asking?
No, it's epicurated circular.
No, okay, so here is, this is example with, so there are, so there is one, there is one marked point on CP1. CP1, which corresponds to x equals infinity, and the singularity is irregular there, yes.
So this corresponds to this nf equals 0. The
yes, it's nf equals 0. There is no flavors. This is the original example is corresponds to Hitchin system on CP1 with one irregular singularity. Mm-hmm. Other questions?
Do you use interpretation of P as a vacuum in three-dimensional series?
Yes. But I didn't tell it yet, but yes. Okay, so, okay. Now, the next example. Well, you can, I just mentioned, I will not explain details because of lack of time, but I'll mention that you can similarly construct this spectral covers, not for GLR, but for arbitrarily simple Lie group. For that, you use the prim variety of the spectral cover using the action of the Weyl group, which permutes the eigenvalues in some representation. And so, described by Danagi. Okay, so most generally, you study the Hitchin system with arbitrary number of marked points, possibly with regular or irregular singularities, and you can choose various gauge groups for that Hitchin system. So that's one class of theories. This class of theories, let me put it here. So little table, n equals 2d equals 4 QFTs. And here, Hitchin system. So Hitchin system is parameterized by the choice of G, the curve C, let's say, of some genus G with mark points. I will not write it. Now, what is it for n equals 2d equals 4 QFT? The corresponding n equals 2d equals 4 QFT is constructed as follows. You start with a 0, 2 supersymmetric tensor theory. In 6D. This theory doesn't have Lagrangian description. It has a string theory description. The theory is equal to type 2B string theory, compactified on the space C2 mod gamma, gamma sub G, where gamma sub G is Mackay corresponding discrete subgroup of SU2 associated to G. And let me fix here G to be simply laced. G is ADE. There are twisted constructions for non-simply laced cases as well. But start with that one. So there is six-dimensional theory given by type 2B string on C2 mod gamma sub G. This theory doesn't have gauge fields. It has the field strength. If you take a abelian example of the theory, then the field strength of that field theory is a three-form, and the connection, like the field potential is two-form. So in some sense, it's a gauge theory for the space of Jaurès, but it never worked out on classical level to make any sense of that. So we just stay with the string theory definition of the theory. Now you take that one important property of that theory, one of defining property of the theory, is if you compactify it on a circle, you get a five-dimensional theory, and that five-dimensional theory is maximally supersymmetric Young-Mills. So this theory has 16 supercharges. Remember, in the classification of theories, the 0,1 theories had 8 supercharges, so this one has 16. Now take that theory and consider the reduction of the theory on the space, on the space-time R3 times S1 times that curve C. So if you take the six-dimensional theory and do the reduction NS1, you get a five-dimensional theory. It would be 5D super Young-Mills with the group G on R3 times C. And then if you go to the infrared to the low energies, or take the distances on R3 much bigger than the distances on C, then you would have the space of maps from R3 to the vacuum of super Young-Mills theory reduced on C. And the equations of the maximal supersymmetric Young-Mills on C is precisely Hitchin equations. So the reduction of the theory gives the maps from R3 to the modular space of Hitchin system on C. And, Maxim mentioned that I didn't explain it yet. So what is the interpretation of the total phase space of the integrable system P to U? So in other words, what is the QFT interpretation of that abelian variety that we attach to each point of the module space of OQ? It actually has very natural interpretation, namely P is the modular space of OQ of D equals 4 and equals 2 QFT, let me put here Coulomb branch, of D equals 4 and equals 2 QFT on R3 times S1. So the extra moduli of the three-dimensional theory are the Wilson loops of the gauge connection around S1 for the electric one and for the magnetic one. So they give two periodic scalars for each scalar of the original four-dimensional theory. So the modular space of the theory compactified on R3 times S1 doubles, and the fibers of the projection, they are the extra moduli which appear in the three dimensions. So the low-energy three-dimensional theory is the nonlinear sigma model for the maps from three dimensions to the hyperkeller modular space, P, and here it comes just as the modular space of Hitchin system.
So So U was the Coulomb branch of the moduli of vacua on D equals what N equals 2 QFT on R4.
Yeah, so this is on R4, and this is on R3 times this one. It has extra moduli, and the projection is when you shrink this, sorry, when you size this one up and expand it and make it R, then that extra moduli go away, and the fiber of this projection shrinks to zero. So roughly speaking, the size of the fibers AU is the inverse of the size of this is one, let me call it vertical. Well, when I'm talking about the size, I'm talking about the whole physical information about the hypercolor metric on it. If you keep track only of the complex structure on the fiber, then the complex structure doesn't depend on the size of the circle. So the holomorphic symplectic space, this vibration P over U doesn't depend on the size of the circle S1. But the metric depends, as roughly as I've written there.
What was the connection between the R4, you know, the R3 cross S1 and the C2 modulo gamma? Are they just different, or?
R3 times S1 times C.
What was the relation between that thing of dimension 4 and the C2 modulo gamma?
C2 gamma makes its dimension 10.
It's got 10, okay.
Yes. So you take type B on C2 mod gamma, and there is, so this is a conic singularity, yes? And there is a low energy theory, which doesn't have Lagrangian description, but it's a quantum field theory with excitations which have mass much less than the string scale. And that quantum field theory is what people call 0,2 theory associated to simply laced Lie algebra G of the type AD. So then you take it, it's six-dimensional theory, and you consider it on the space-time of this form. So four-dimensional space-time R3 times S1 times C. So the reduction of this 0,2 theory on C gives a four-dimensional theory, and that four-dimensional theory is the one which corresponds to the integrable system of the Hitchin type. So this is this whole thing is called Gajota-Witten construction. And the theories, the n equals 2 theories of this type are called theories of class S.
Someone told me that S stands for 6. Is that common or standard?
That S stands for 6?
Yeah.
Maybe. You need to ask Greg Moore, I believe.
Right.
Yes. This notation was introduced in one of papers by Greg Moore, Antonetsky, and David Gajota. Okay, so that was example, concrete example of one class related to that arrow. Yes, so that relates quantum theories in D equals 4 and integrable systems. So for Hitchin systems, we explained what are the corresponding quantum field theories. Now let's do another example.
But these integrable systems, they don't have a preferred Hamiltonian flow, and they are integrable.
You mean they don't have preferred choice of Hamiltonian?
Yes.
Yes, there is a space where Hamiltonian take value. This is the U plane. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Also, is this total space P a bit correctly cotangent bounded for some nature? Is it just simply a picnic? The Hitchin system knows cotangent bounded space for bundles. Yeah?
Yes, exactly.
What is the physical origin of cotangent bundle? Or maybe it's not necessary.
It's not necessary. So we are going to consider the next example where it's not a cotangent bundle. Okay, so the next example also in the class of Mukai construction for P is the following. So Okay, so in the first example, we've taken the surface S just to be T star of C, okay, and we've taken the Hitchin system on C. Now let's take for the S another simple surface which you can imagine. Well, we could go all the way up to K3, but before we do that, so let's S to be just a product of two abelian curves. So let me call them C horizontal times C vertical, and C horizontal C vertical would be either C mod Z or C mod Z2. So that's a cylinder and that's elliptic curve. Yes, with the nature of flat structure on CH. And C vertical, we consider the cases for C mod Z, the cylinder, and C mod Z2. So that's elliptic curve. If you take the case when C vertical is just C, then we can identify that space S to the contingent bundle of C horizontal, and the construction reduces to Hitchin system that we've considered already. So we can think about these cases, CH times CV, where CV is a cylinder or elliptic curve, as like trigonometric or elliptic generalization of a Hitchin system. So that the Higgs field, instead of being valued in the algebra, becomes valued here for this case in the group, and in this case in the modular space of G bundles on this vertical elliptic curve. So concretely, we do the following. We consider G bundles.
Again, S is a surface.
Yes, S is a complex surface. Yes. So the product of two flat curves. Yes. So you consider G bundles on CH times CV. Yes. So this is a symplectic space. It's holomorphic symplectic space. That would be the total space P. So what is the space U? Well, the space U is similar to how we did in the case of Hitchin system. So there we've taken the spectral of the Higgs field phi. Now now we think about the Higgs field phi as the restriction of the G bundle on the vertical curve. So the modular space, I mean the base of the vibration would be the space of holomorphic maps from the horizontal curve CH to the modular space of G bundles on the vertical curve CV. So more concretely, what I mean here is, so the modular space of G bundles on a cylinder is just the group itself, since we need only to specify the holonomy on a cylinder around the non-contractible circle. The modular space of G bundles on the elliptic curve.
Holomorphic bundles result in connection. Maybe you just
Right. So when it's elliptic curve, is just precisely the modular space of G bundles on elliptic curve, and algebraic geometrically can be identified with the weighted projective space, with the weights given by a naught dot dot ar, where these are dual Coxeter numbers. Of G. So, for example, if G is SL2, then you have just P1. Okay, and so the U is the maps from CH to Banji on CV with a proper trivialization when CV is the cylinder. And the projection is just a restriction of the structure of G bundle to a given fiber at a point of CH. So there is a projection. And this projection is turns out to be Lagrangian. So the fibers are Lagrangian. And that gives integrable system.
Is the base a fine variety?
Well, in the case when CH is C and C mod Z, then the bases are fine variety. Yeah. If the base is an elliptic curve, yeah, then I think it's not. Like if you take just, you know, run.
Because for physics, why you should expect a fine, yeah, in general for physics you expect maybe you lose this.
Oh yes. So I didn't I didn't explain that, but actually I'm coming exactly to it. So it turns out that the integrable systems associated to this construction, they correspond to the gauge theories, to the following class of gauge theories. You take finite dimensional. Yes. Yes, fine dimension. By the way, similar to that hyperkeller description of Hitchin system, we can give a hyperkeller description of those objects, the case of the full rank, when everything is elliptic curve, then you just study the modular space of instantons on the product of two elliptic curves. When the vertical curve is a cylinder, then it turns out that the corresponding modular space is the modular space of monopole equations. So in this case, you take G monopoles on C horizontal curve times S1. And for us, G monopoles on C horizontal times S1 is, roughly speaking, trigonometric version of Hitchin system on C horizontal. And so the Higgs field is, well, in the algebra, is replaced by the holonomy of the gauge connection around S1. Okay, so the corresponding gauge theories turn out to be given as follows. You take a certain G quiver gauge theory in 6D. So here I fix G to be of ADE. Or ADE hat. So a fine or non-affine or finite simply laced Lie algebra. And the quiver gauge theory, we covered it in the last, in the first lecture, is a theory where the gauge group is a product of SU and I's. So each simple factor corresponds to a node in the quiver diagram. The quiver diagram is Dynkin of G. Let's call G gauge group the product of SU and I's. And hypermultiplet is defined by counting the arrows between the nodes. So each arrow corresponds to hypermultiplet, and by fundamental representation between given node I and given node J. And fundamental representations labeled by squares attached to each node on this quiver diagram. So you take this quiver gauge theory in six dimensions, and then you consider it a compactification on the curve C on the dual to C horizontal. So by dual, I mean that I'm keeping now not only the complex structure, but really take that curve is a metric, and the dual in a sense of the dual torus. So if C horizontal is R2, then so the dual one would be point. If C horizontal is cylinder, then C horizontal is point times S1. And if that's elliptic curve, then this one is dual. Yes, the limit of tori where both cycles shrink to zero. Okay, so this is really four-dimensional theory. This is a 5D theory reduced on S1, and this is 6D theory reduced on elliptic curve. Let me call it, okay, C horizontal dual. Yes, this is elliptic curve. So now recall that classically we parameterized the module space of vacua by A, and A in the four dimensions is just the complex scalar, and it comes from the reduction of the gauge connection components of the 6D theory. So here A is just in the Lie algebra, the complexified Lie algebra of the gauge group of the G gauge. So here you would parameterize the moduli of the four-dimensional theory, which is obtained by KK reduction of the five-dimensional theory on S1 by a periodic scalar, since it comes from the a modular space of connections around that vertical S1 direction and transversal component. So A would be given as a holonomy of A5, if I call this vertical direction along S1 the fifth direction, plus the scalar phi, which comes from the reduction of the sixth component of the 6D theory. So here, A takes value in the group. And here, the modular space of vacua are parameterized by the connection, by the flat connection on CH. So here, A connection on CH. So for rank one, it's just CH itself. Okay, and therefore the module space is not affine anymore for this 6D theory. So
that means that the set theory will have no ultraviolet description.
Yes, it doesn't have. No, I mean just that field is not valued as C. It's valued. It's elliptically valued.
So the really no observable, which mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, so I've explained this example. So to that integrable system, when S is a product of CH times CV, to it corresponds a quiver gauge theory. Well, for the case when G is a simply laced AD or AD head, and CH, the type of CH labels the dimensionality and the reduction of this theory, Namely, you take 6D theory reduced completely to 4D, 6D reduced on S1, or 6D reduced on elliptic curve. And for CV, we had two cases when CV is a cylinder and CV is an elliptic curve. And those two cases, they differentiate between whether we take for the quiver type here finite quiver or affine quiver. So the finite quiver corresponds to the vertical curve being the cylinder, and the affine quiver corresponds to the vertical curve being the elliptic curve. Okay, so that's another example. So let's finish for today.